Women in ministry come on quickly right behind each other, Christian education and all of the components that are a part thereof, and then we go on from there. While they're coming, come on with me, the real church. The real church.
The real church.
Still there in the
belief. Still there.
I am.
Davis, presiding elders, sisters and brothers in vocational ministry, and members of the Second Episcopal District, it is my joy and honor to make this brief report on behalf of women in ministry. After three challenging years of separation, isolation, illness, loss, uncertainty, and unwavering faith, we are grateful for a post-pandemic gathering of the whole and declare we remain the real church, still daring to believe. We give God glory for our Episcopal leadership. Thank you, Bishop and Mother Davis, for your love, support, and encouragement. As an organization, we celebrate the leadership of all of our beloved presiding elders, and of course, give a special shout out to Reverend Evelyn Gail Dunn, recently retired Reverend Dr. Anita M. Thompson, and Reverend Wanda E. London. They all model excellence in ministry and learning. Operating under the theme Walking in Strength, Iron Sharpening Iron, WIM declares to believe the Church of Allen remains a voice of encouragement and empowerment for all. In spite of blatant and subtle attempts to dismantle laws guaranteeing equality, equity, parity, and social, racial, and gender justice, we still dare to believe a liberating Jesus will prevail. We still dare to believe the government is on his shoulders. And we still dare to believe when the church works together, we all overcome. Statistically, we are one of the strongest Episcopal districts, with nearly 700 clergy women, including 400 in itinerant ministry and 250 in local ministry. We are grateful that our servant bishop continues to elevate and intentionally include clergy women in all areas and levels of leadership throughout the district. Thank you, Bishop Davis. And so, because we still dare to believe that the best is yet to come, our action items for this year include continue We Speak, Women Empowered to Speak, monthly virtual sessions which offer honest conversation, information sharing, and encouragement for all. Number two, encourage intentional clergy self-care and professional development by convening a Second District Women in Ministry Conference. Number three, support the Connectional Women in Ministry Initiative to purchase disciplines for our sister and brother clergy in global districts 14 through 20. Many are pastoring, leading, and training without access to any disciplines. And number four, increase collaboration with other components and increase associate membership of our brother clergy, WMS, and the laity. We remain hopeful because when iron sharpens iron, the entire body of Jesus is empowered. Respectfully submitted, Women in Ministry Executive Board and Conference Coordinators, we thank you, Bishop Davis, for the opportunity to serve.
Bishop Davis, Mother Relis Davis, to this August body meeting today, We are pleased to stand before you to give our report for Christian education. Standing strongly and proudly with me are the components. And if you will look on page 17, you will find a listing, and we want to add some additional names as well. We have standing before us today, in addition to the ones listed, the Association of AME Scouts, Brother Clarence Clayton. We also have with us music and choir and Christian ministry. We have Reverend Anthony Radcliffe and Reverend Dina. Oh, and Reverend Dana Porter Ashton standing with us. We are pleased to report to you that we stand connected. We have come together to do the work assigned to our hands as the real church, still daring to believe. The real church, I am the difference. And from that we will hear the report, the combined report of Christian education for the Second Episcopal District by our illustrious co and partner.
Amen. Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, Bishop. Thank you for the opportunity to present the action items on behalf of Christian education. Number one, to promote the Second Episcopal District Christian education objective of making a difference by still daring to believe in spiritual and Christian empowerment through reimagining Christian values. Number two, to keep the Christian education director on every level apprised of our stages of development, goals, and resources. Number three, to update and, as necessary, revise our annual conference reporting process that we use to capture relevant information from all of our Christian education components. And fourth and final, to issue our report forms earlier and to develop an update and to emphasize the process so that the needs and the concerns of the local churches are identified and addressed. Those are our action items for Christian education. Other component leaders are present.
To Bishop James LeVert Davis, to Bishop E. Earl McLeod, I'm pleased to be able to present. This is my first report as the president of the Second Episcopal District, Richard Allen Young Adult Council. In 1978, a young man who pastored in Birmingham was elected fourth Connectional International RAAC president. And then a few years later, in 2004, the church saw fit to elect him the 123rd elected and consecrated bishop of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, who now serves in our district, Bishop James LeVert Davis. To that end, the theme for this biennial for the Richard Allen Young Adult Council is Sankofa, leaving no stone unturned. We are going back to get what we already have so that we can go where we're destined to head. Over this past year, we have, for the first time in the history of the Second Episcopal District, had a RAAC president in every annual conference. Wow. Amen. Not only that, we have had activities and programming in every annual conference. And in addition to that, we have had more people involved in RAAC in over the last year than we have had in recent memory. And that is something to be excited about. Now, to that end, I would like to share some of the action items that we have. First action item, also, there should be a QR code. They couldn't put it up. Well, there's a QR code where you can get all of our report so that you can see all the wonderful things that we've been doing. I printed it out at Kinko's, but I couldn't pay enough to get everybody in here unless y'all want to cash at me. Amen? Yeah. But our action item first is to encourage and train local pastors and Christian educators to establish RAAC chapters within their local churches. Because in our annual conference reports, we see that there are 300 and some odd RAAC members, but those of us who have made pastoral reports know the understanding of these two words, on roll. And so what we would like to do in our local churches is to establish RAAC chapters, and really all you need to do is start with at least one person. That's the first action item. Second action item is to establish cross-functional relationships with other components. One of the first conversations I had with Bishop Davis when I took this office was that the RAYC, R-A-Y-C, was a council of different organizations that came together so we were all on the same page. We want to make sure that RAYAC is taken just as seriously as any other component in this church. So we are connecting with the Women's Missionary Society, with the YPD, with the lay organization to make sure that RAYAC can be a gateway when kids are coming out of YPD to find other organizations for them to be a part of in the church. Amen. Third action item is to develop more opportunities for intergenerational dialogue and storytelling. It's not enough for us to tell we don't understand the church if we don't know the stories that will help us understand the church. That's the third action item. The fourth action item is to continue to make space for RAYAC in both our annual conference and our district-wide meetings. And I want to take this moment to acknowledge the fact that as I've been AME my whole life, I don't care what nobody says. And I have seen a lot of bishops make a lot of promises, but one of the things I've seen is that this bishop, our bishop, has done more to elevate and to position young adult clergy and lay than any other bishop that I have seen in the Second Episcopal District. And to that end, when he leaves in 2024, it is our job to make sure that we don't revert the progress that we got over these last 8 years. So before I conclude my report, of course we have our young adult service on Wednesday. At that service we will be debuting our RAYAC praise team, amen. But also you will see members of the RAYAC wearing some baseball jerseys. And because we know that we are in the presence of a former international RAYC president, we wanted to present both you and the supervisor with your own jerseys. Turn them around so they can see with your names on them. Amen. So I don't know how well that goes with your nice three-piece suits, Bishop Davis, but if you would like to wear them, you are perfectly fine. So you can go ahead, go good night. You go to the bishop. Don't tell him to come up. That's AME 101. Amen. Amen. Can all of those who are members of RAYAC and also between the ages of 21 and 45, if you can stand while you still got your good knees, amen, stand. Amen. I know it's been a while since you've been to the club, but we still check IDs at the door, amen. Thank you so much for the opportunity to serve Bishop.
Sons of Allen video, please. That was awesome.
Bishop, the PowerPoint and video comes after me.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it comes after me.
Okay, as long as you know that.
Yeah, praise me. Uh-huh. But I must say that is hard act to follow. It's a good thing we're not competing.
And you say,
stand the change. Glory to God, we don't have any t-shirts.
Report. I said, well, do just fine.
But anyway, to Bishop and Bishop, filed a ball of summer here for this planning meeting. Summer, gentlemen. We, Second Episcopal District Sons of Allen, beg leave our report. We had a very productive meeting today, focusing on the theme, connecting and reigniting the Sons of Allen. Co-coordinators from all five conferences were present and strongly contributed, as well as members. We are moving forward with our future plans with great excitement. I will yield to co-coordinator Mark Wood at this time to finish our report. And yes, Bishop, we believe as men, we are the difference.
For protocol being established, Bishop, thank you for the opportunity to serve. As you see on the screens,
We do have some items. We want to bring unity throughout the 2nd District. We're trying to help start and strengthen local branches. Trying to find ways to support men in the HBCUs. We have all these HBCUs. We got to find ways to help some brothers so they ain't got to just keep eating oodles and noodles every night. Amen? Amen. Amen. We got to strengthen our young men's ministry. We have to support our very own AME Empowerment Center in Raleigh, North Carolina. Amen? Amen. We have to bring back our annual Sons of Allen retreat, and I didn't even know you were going to talk about this, Bishop, but we have to start posting voter registration drives. We got to get young black men knowing that you have to vote. We go to the next slide, please. There you go. And the action item, we're trying to just get information from all 5 coordinators and the district coordinators. We are trying to recruit men with the emphasis on young men. Let me say to all of the other components, we say thank you for what you're doing, especially the YPD and the Women's Missionary Society. But we understand that it takes a man to raise a man. Is this on? Did y'all hear that? Y'all are doing a phenomenal job, but it takes a man to raise a man. Can I, one more time, it takes a man to raise a man. That's why the Sons of Allen are still here, and we're just like the little internet could. We think we can, and we're just going to keep on pressing on. If you could play that video from your young brother over there, just play the video, and then we'll let you go. Bishop Davis, I know you were giving away checks, so you can just make your check out to the Sons of Allen Minute Ministry. We will gladly accept. God bless your life, sir. Won't play? It's all right, it won't play. But we just had a video just showing the necessity of men being men. And in this day and age, we need strong men to help keep black men out of the prison system. Amen? God bless you, and may heaven continue to smile upon you.
Bishop Davis, Bishop McCloud, Eagle Scouts, Bishop McCloud. The Association of AME Scouts want to let you all know that the Scouts are alive and well, that we have a Girl Scout convention coming up, that we are sending Scouts, Girl Scout representatives there in the month of July here in a couple of weeks. We're also having Boy Scouts going to the Boy Scout National Jamboree in the month of July in just a couple of weeks. We are doing we have a scholarship funds that we're doing, that we present to the Eagle Scouts and the Girl Scouts as well. We're also doing 5Ks. We've done a 5K last year where we had about 200 folks coming together, but we expect to do it again this year. We'll do one in October, and we'll do another one in April of next year that we'll be doing. And we're also doing Christmas cards and fundraisers as we move forward. But we believe that scouting, Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts, make a difference in the lives of our youth. It gives them the networking that they need in order to move forward. And with the foundation of this church and with the foundation of scouting, we think we make a difference in the lives of our youth as they move forward. So thank you, sir.
Put your hands together.
Bishop Davis, we would like to conclude our reports by saying we have been able to have the Summer Summit running as it's running because all of those components have been behind us and with us, and they are also helping us right now to keep things in order. We know that it takes a village, and that's what we are trying to model, that village where our children can be protected and we can move ahead and do what God would have us to do. We are the difference. God bless you.
Before you leave from up there, could you please, those component areas, the young adults, the children, would you please ask them to stand and tell the folks who they are in terms of the Christian education layout. Okay, just so we might recognize all of them as well.
Okay, Sons of Alvin, you're talking.
Well, I'm talking about those appointed places, the coordinators of young adults, the coordinators, those persons are who I'm talking about.
Yes. The coordinators for the various areas, I know you're somewhere here, would you please stand? For children, we have Reverend Russell St. Bernard.
He's not here today.
Okay, for the youth, Reverend Ware is for young adults. And for adults, we have Reverend Christina Reed, would you please stand? These are the coordinators who work with all of us and put this together. Reverend Christina Reed, who is the coordinator for adults.
All right. Give them all a hand.
And in addition, Bishop, to all of the Christian educators at every level, we're looking to you to help us to bring this to fruition.
Certainly, you all have managed to involve more folks than I ever thought possible, and all of the groups working together in harmony, and we commend you for that, both you and the co-coordinator, Director of Christian Education. So put your hands together.
Couldn't have done it without her. All right.
The real church. The real church.
The real church.
Still daring to believe.
Still daring to believe.
I am.
The
difference. All right. Before you leave here, you don't know that. All right. Environmental justice, home purchasing, EPA, EAP, and then we move on to educational support. But right now, Dr. Mark Whitlock, come on.
We invite all of the Environmental Justice Committee to come up forward. Bishop James Davis, Bishop Cloud, clergy, mother supervisor, WMS components, and later, second Episcopal district of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. We greet you in Jesus' joy.
Can you hear me?
No.
Very faint.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
You got to try Verizon. It is better than the other system. Man. February the 12th, 1968, the sanitation workers in Memphis, Tennessee, met at Claiborne Temple, AME Church, to start the first faith-based environmental justice movement. It was there that the men went on strike because they were not receiving equal pay. It was there that they did not have things that protected their body. It was there that started the first EJ movement. And we got to celebrate our bishop because the EJ movement in the second district continues. Come on, let's give God praise for our people. We're still having environmental injustice, overcrowded urban areas, increased asthma, lung cancer, and other risk of disease. We deal with toxic water and air, erosion and deforestation create brownfields that become children's playgrounds, shortage of wood for fuel, unwanted trash paint the beauty of our earth. The Bible says that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, but we've done a good job trying to dismantle that which God created for us all. The EJ committee is the difference of for saving the earth. It is our pleasure, Bishop, to make a presentation, our first presentation to this great meeting. We will begin with Reverend Brenda White, who's responsible as chair for Washington, and then we'll follow up with Reverend Robert Yarborough, and I believe, is she here? Yes, she is. Reverend Gloucester will also give us a report. So please, let's listen to them.
Our mission, launched during the planning meeting in 2022, the SED Environmental Justice Ministry mission is and continues to be to promote environmental justice education, advocacy, and both church and community projects in the following areas. Pillar one, sustaining the quality of water. Pillar two, keeping God's environment safe and clean. Pillar three, protecting God's land and air. Pillar four, inspiring intergenerational justice action. Summary of accomplishments. Throughout the Second Episcopal District, churches have participated in the following activities. Partnerships developed with faith-based and environmental organizations, such as the Interfaith Power and Light, Interfaith Partners for the Chesapeake, Maryland Sea Grant, and the Alliance for the Chesapeake Bay, Green the Church National. An environmental site assessment for the Maryland Sea Grant. This assessment will be a great blueprint for future EJ projects. March 2023, completed the IPC, Interfaith Partners for the Chesapeake's Faithful Green Leadership Training Program that teaches environmental stewardship and creates champions to lead. April 2023, with the Alliance for the Chesapeake Bay and the Interfaith Partners for the Chesapeake, 15 trees were planted. In partnership with the University of Maryland Environmental Justice Program, 36 churches installed devices to measure air quality, building a community-based network in communities of color to reduce air pollution and associated health inequities in overburdened communities across the region. Multiple congregations have established local environmental justice ministries. The environmental justice video has been shared and updates have been given at all various district meetings.
Thank you. An incandescent light bulb campaign has been promoted at multiple churches. Church bulletins have highlighted the recent clean air monitoring. EJ was highlighted during various Sunday school conventions. The Nash Edcom Wilson County Cluster hosted environmental justice special guest speaker Dr. Teddy Delange of Uganda. Many church members pledged or renewed their pledges to support recycling efforts in their respective communities. And several churches promoted and encouraged members to purchase electric and hybrid vehicle purchases. Several churches are planning a phantom power bill church challenge with associated incentives.
Our charge, Bishop, to the planning meeting in the Second Episcopal District is for us to continue our work on an annual basis to make a difference for those that have been appointed and reappointed, those have been assigned and reassigned, and those that have a renewed mind to continue what we have laid out on our calendar, which is posted on the district website. August is to get started, to share that environmental justice video. Organize your environmental justice ministry. There are folks that are in your congregation that are excited and compassionate about this subject. To ensure that you are encouraging your members to recycle, purchase hybrid electric vehicles, and to ensure that they're doing pickup trash campaigns. In September, our light bulb campaign is to challenge the congregation and even in your local church to use fluorescent lights. That's your CFL or your LED bulbs. Also in October, for you to preach or print or teach, amen, about environmental justice. In November, to host an environmental justice community outreach and engagement event. Join the Green Church Incorporated and National Environmental Justice Nonprofit Organization. In December, we want you to start a trash recycling program and increase an existing recycling program by the number of trash loads. In January, plan an EJ cluster event or program to host an educational forum like the one done in Nash, Edgecombe, Wilson County on environmental justice. And in February, challenge your congregation to consider purchasing again, amen, a low fuel gas fast or an electric or hybrid vehicle, and in March, initiate a safe water testing campaign. World Water Day is March the 22nd. Research area agencies, amen, as well as in April, investigate research and submit your grant applications to support your local church and community EJ of their efforts. And there is a plethora of monies available. Please contact your respective representatives. And lastly, in May, develop a non-church EJ partnership in your church's immediate community.
Bishop, that's our report. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to make a difference in our community where we live, working
on. All right. Come on, y'all. I am.
I am.
Yeah.
thank you, and certainly we look forward to continuous monthly emphasis that's put out there for everybody to bring themselves closer and closer to know that they are the difference in their own communities, in their own home, as it relates to the environment.
Mr. Mayor, this report was written and put together by my wife, who made sure we did a great job on it. Could you please give her a big hand?
Let me, and thank you. Thank you, Reverend Dr. Mia. Anybody, there's been so much denial of the environmental devastation and how climate change has altered everything. If you're not a believer now, you need to go and stand outside.
Mama.
Breathe the air.
Mama.
The world is not what it was, and we're making it worse.
Amen.
And so I would implore all of us to do our small part and be that difference. Somebody ought to shout out amen anyhow.
Amen.
As we talk about political awareness of everything, certainly there is nothing less political about how we approach this issue of environmental control and improvement of our environment. It's hard to talk about voting if you're not alive to do it.
Mama.
I just said something. All right. And certainly the foods that we eat, grown in an environment where there's so much pollution. You hear, and Lord knows, fires everywhere, water that has never been in places that it is now. The fact that you can't go out of your own home without a mask because the breathing, the air that you breathe is so contaminated by fires coming from various directions of the world, wildfires. Let's do our part. Let's unplug some of the appliances in the house that are not being used. Somebody say
all right.
Amen. Let's turn out some lights that you are not using.
Yes.
Let's make sure that we drive at a moderate rate so we don't have to use those of us who are still driving gasoline cars, so we don't have to use so much gas and pollution that comes as a result of that. Everybody wants it to be better. Nobody wants to help to make it better. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
All right, come on now. Home purchasing, we have a special guest who's going to take his few minutes to share with us. And someone asked, why do I keep inviting USF Wholesale back with us? It's because they're doing something for our people. You may not be aware of it, but the numbers of persons that this company has helped in this Episcopal district, to help get loans for new homes, first-time home buyers. We are excited with those who are making a difference with our people. And you're going to have to pay the loan back by yourself, and they're not in the business of doing that, but they can help you to get there, and they've proven that over and over again. Mr. Grant, the president of USF Wholesale Mortgage, come on, and he's going to take his few minutes to share with us how and what he has to offer in order to help those of us who are still looking for that first piece of the American dream, our homes. I've said it over and over again, the reality of it is our homes need more to us than they do in some communities. Our homes are the bonds to get people out of jail. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Our homes are the emergency fund to help send our children to school. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Our homes are the money that we use when we run into circumstances beyond our control, health difficulties, and not being able to work. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Our homes are really our million-dollar value, though they may not register for $230,000 on the market or $300,000 on the market. For black folk, our home is the first step to becoming, putting ourselves in a retirement situation. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
All right, Mr. Grant, go right ahead.
First of all, Bishop Davis, thank you so much. You've been incredibly generous to us ever since we met about 6 years ago. And thanks to Dr. Weaver, we met, and when we met you all, it was around a movement called Black Wealth 2020. And we wanted to find a way to promote the idea of intergenerational wealth. We wanted to promote the idea that if we pull our resources together, like everybody else does, we will be stronger financially. You with me?
Yeah.
I think, Dr. Weaver, I think you introduced me to the Bishop, and ever since then we have had a fabulous relationship, so thank you very much, Bishop. My friends, I just want to kind of connect some of these dots. We had three goals with Black Wealth 2020. Correct me, Jonathan, if I get off on this. We wanted to build up black businesses. We wanted to build up the number and the gross receipts. We wanted to put 2 million people in homes, okay? And we wanted to encourage people to put deposits in and get loans with black banks, okay? Those three pillars. And the person who kicked off our luncheon speech to start the whole thing was none other than Congresswoman Maxine Waters. And she fired everybody up in the room, and so we were ready to go to work after her speech. So let me tell you what I'm here today. First of all, our bishop is right. I have a form here. This is all about mortgages. If you or anybody in your family or in your church has been thinking about a home, they may be concerned about their credit, you know, they may have some other concerns, take one of these forms and fill it out for us. Nobody's going to pressure sell anybody. But if we get information back from you, we will call you and say, who is interested in a home or who's interested in a mortgage and how can we help? Some people say, but my credit is not good. Don't worry about your credit, okay? There's a whole bunch of millionaires walking around in this country who had bad credit. Huh? They figured out a way to navigate around it. True or false? We got to start helping each other. One thing I like about this bank I'm going to tell you something about is black businesses in the country were having a hard time getting these loans. So we went to Liberty Bank, Alden McDonald, who said, listen, we need you to create an affinity card so these banks could have this $10,000, $15,000. Y'all know what I'm talking about. These bridge loans that these big banks weren't giving them. Will you help us get that card? And he said, yes. And so small black businesses across America have an affinity card because of this effort. So the first thing, please, if you have anybody in your family who's interested in either getting a mortgage or refi, fill this out for me. Now here's the second part. Alden has asked us to tell the ministers in the room. How many ministers in the room? Raise your hand, please. Oh my Lord. This is a minister's conference. Listen, he said this. He said if you have a need for a bank loan, I know a lot of you want to expand or do renovations, right? You want to do things in your church, and you may have gone through some problems with the bigger banks. Listen, just put church on the top of this paper, and we'll call you. If you need a loan to expand or to renovate or do anything like that in your church, just let us know, and we'll put you in touch with Alden McDonald, because that is something you can do. Fair enough?
Yeah,
nah. I think I've got, there's some hands up, and you guys want some a form, right? Hey, guys, we have some more form here. Can I give everybody my phone number, please, my cell phone? Please write it down and I will return your phone call. 7 days a week. The bishop knows, the bishop, James Davis calls me. He knows I'm going to get back, right, bishop?
Yes, sir.
It's the only way to do it. It's the only way to do it. So call me 6 days a week up to 9 or 10 o'clock at night, and I promise you, I will get back with you, okay? Bishop, can I take a question or two, or should we finish?
Sure. We have time for two questions. If you have a question, please stand. Wait.
My phone number, are you ready? This is my cell. It's 615-961-7224. 615-961-7224. Let me give you my personal email account. If y'all take it down?
Yeah.
It's mikeagrant@hotmail.com. mikeagrant@hotmail.com. My partner traveling with me today is Victor Cook. He's the brains behind so much of what we try to accomplish. Vic, stand up so the people at AME can see you. Y'all recognize Victor Cook, would you please? He's the guy who keeps me organized. Any questions about anything?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
You're welcome. You said people say they're worried about the credit. My oldest son and his wife make pretty decent money.
Yes, sir.
But they have bad credit. What kind of... Is there a ballpark, I guess, in terms of credit that would help facilitate and his wife buying something?
We would love, ideally, my friend, we would love you to have a credit score of 620, 640, okay? That's kind of a low, but it'll get you in. But if you have a credit score that's in the 500s, just call me, okay? And put you in touch with the folks who know how to help you work through a process. Now, whether it's consolidating loans, or consolidating student debt, or whatever we have to do, okay? We're not going to let you go. We're going to work with you until your credit score is where we can accept you, and then we'll put you through the process. Fair enough? But don't let credit stop you from going after a home. Please, friends. Please. I've known too many folks who are wealthy now who had horrible credit. Anybody else? Question?
All right.
Okay. We got to have them collect these things, guys.
Here's how to ask the question. Don't get here.
I'm sorry.
Please stand. Just.
Yes. Yes. You come to the bench. Now, our mortgage company doesn't do HELOCs, but Liberty Bank will do a HELOC for you, yes. Okay? So just put on the top of that, your paper, Liberty Bank, and I'll get your folks
there. Everybody wants to know what the HELOC is.
No, it's a home equity line of credit. It's a home equity line. You got some equity in your home, right? And you want to get a line of credit. You may not need the whole $50,000. You just might need to use $10,000. So you got the credit. Hello? Listen, I want to thank the AME Church. We've been around this country, and nobody, nowhere, has been more receptive to the things we've been trying to do than the AME Church. God bless you so much for that. Bishop, I take a lot of time. Thank you. How do we get the forms back across?
All of you who have those forms, please fill them out quickly, and Reverend Nix will be walking the aisle quietly and receiving them. All right, thank you so very much. The Reverend Aline, Dr. Aline, the video, please, up with EAP. Quickly. Hello? Was that it?
Yes, sir.
My name is Joshua Hayes. I'm a licensed clinical social worker and therapist in D.C. and Maryland. Here on behalf of the EAP for the 2nd District for the African American Episcopal Church. And I just wanted to share a concept with you all who are clergy, who are in leadership positions at your respective churches, pastors, those in ministry. And I wanted to share on the concept of toxic positivity. So what is toxic positivity? You might be asking, how can positivity be toxic? So let me give you a definition. Toxic positivity is the idea that no matter what difficult circumstance you're going through or what valid feelings, emotions, and experiences you're having, you have the responsibility to maintain a positive mindset and only give out positive energy and positive vibes to everyone you come in contact with. So you might be asking, how is that a bad thing? How is it bad to have a positive mindset or maintain a positive mindset or give out positive vibes in the midst of some very real and significant emotional challenges? It's difficult because practicing toxic positivity diminishes, dismisses, and suppresses the very real authentic emotions and experiences that you are having as a human being. In ministry, a lot of times, many pastors, clergy, leadership, they feel like they have a responsibility to suppress whatever's going on with them, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, for the sake of the church, the congregation, families, friends. They feel like they have the responsibility to hold it together for everyone and only give out positive energy and maintain a positive mindset, even when they might be struggling internally. This is very damaging and can do a lot of harm for your mental well-being, because it doesn't allow you to address some very real things that may be going on in your life. You're both human and divine. I like to remind a lot of clergy that they're both human and divine. And even though you have a calling on your life and an anointing to lead God's people, you are also still human. So you still have very real emotions. You still have some experiences, some trauma, some things that make it challenging sometimes. And you deserve to have the support you need. So I want to encourage you to be aware of where you are and connect to some people, specifically the EAP for the African Methodist Episcopal Church, some people that are there to help you, support you, provide some guidance, and provide you some tools to help you navigate those very real and authentic emotions and feelings that you might be experiencing. So thank you for your time, and I hope that you will allow yourself to get everything that you need so you can continue serving God's people. Thank you.
And Mother Davis, thank you for this opportunity to present, and thank God for Brother Joshua Hayes to remind us that toxic positivity is not positive. You know, for example, we have people, when you lose a loved one, we so quick to say, well, they're in heaven now. Haven't you heard that before? But we're negating that we're hurting, that we're grieving, and it's all right to grieve, and it's all right to hurt. It's even all right to get angry. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Okay, so we want to take care of ourselves. And we thank God for the clergy care team of the Second Episcopal District. We ask that you might stand. Your district representatives are here to give you more information regarding the EAP program. The telephone number is 800-252-4555. Or you can go to the EAP.com. There will be flyers listed, posted outside for you to pick up. And it's not only just for counseling, but also coaching, dealing with life challenges, dealing with homeownership, dealing with student loans, home purchasing, effective communication, and becoming, balancing life and work as well. So we ask that you take advantage of the EAP program. The EAP program will make a difference in your life.
Amen.
Thank you, Bishop, for the opportunity.
Thank you. And what I'm going to ask now is that we have exactly 40 minutes before we want to be out of here in order to give you a chance to be ready for tonight's service. So I'm going to ask everybody to be as brief as possible in your next presentations, because I think we have copies of your reports as well. The educational support, come on. Theological education, Dr. Carter, Alan Adams Scholarship, and Radcliffe, she's spoken to the board this morning. HBCUs will come out on the report of the education fund, and so I want to ask Dr. Bryce to present now. The health ministry projections, prayer ministry has been here with us, and we know their contribution to us in chaplains. Thank you. I represent the chaplains. Come on, please.
Thank you, Bishop Davis, Bishop McLeod, Supervisor Davis, Second District Planning Meeting, our report for the Theological Scholarship Committee was compiled a video by Dr. Anna Mosby and Dr. Marietta Ramsey. Play the video at this time.
Please put the video on. Put the video on, please. Are we experiencing difficulty?
rather than taking time to wait on that, I'm going to ask Reverend and Sister Rector, Ms. Rector, to come. And when they come up, you know, as soon as they are able to run, we will allow them to run. Go right there, Ms. Rector.
Good afternoon, Bishop Davis, Mother Davis, Bishop McLeod, and the members of the real church still daring to believe. I greet you with the joy of Jesus. On behalf of the Kitchell Allen Adams Scholarship Fund Board of Trustees and Conference Chairpersons, I make this report. Will the board members and conference chairpersons please stand? For the 2022-23 school year, we were able to award a total of $12,500 in scholarships. Each conference received $2,500 for their awardees. The Baltimore Conference awarded 4 scholarships, ranging from $500 to $1,000, Brother Alvin White, chairperson. The Washington Conference awarded 4 scholarships, ranging from $200 to $1,000, Sister Marie Blake, chairperson. The Virginia Conference awarded 7 scholarships, ranging from $250 to $500, Sister Barbara Richmond, chairperson. The North Carolina Conference awarded 3 scholarships, $833 each, Sister Gwen Smith, chairperson. The Western North Carolina Conference awarded 5 scholarships, ranging from $200 to $1,000, Sister Sonia Barbary, chairperson. Funds from our scholarships come from the interest accrued yearly. The interest is from 3 sources. The endowment fund, which was created in 1943. The trust agreement, which was created in 1988. No funds are currently coming from the church now. These are what they call old money. Old money. We currently have a CD with M&F Bank for $270,000, $270,776.01. A second CD, $100,000 with M&F Bank. The endowment fund, current market value, $206,976.69. An investment fund with Wells Fargo, current market value, $138,655.89. We do have a savings with M&F Bank, $14,110.23, and the checking account, $11,646.22 with Bank of America. The total amount of money is $742,165. To God be the glory. It's still time to apply for the 2023 scholarship. The due date is July 31st, 2023. Applications and supporting documents should be postmarked no later than July 31st, 2023. This year we were blessed in that the 2023 application has a YouTube tutorial embedded in the application. So you can get it from the internet. Brother White from Baltimore Conference and one of our young men will guide the young person through the process such that you will have an award-winning application. I do ask moms and dads, encourage your young people to make the effort. The applications were distributed originally in February. We send them out to the presiding elders, then to the pastors, WMS, and lay leadership. Also, to get an application, you can contact your conference chairpersons. We also send out the applications again in June after the new presiding elders were appointed. Bishop Davis, Mother Davis, we thank you so much for your continued support. And I thank you for the prayers of the conference. One last comment. If you will remember, a few years ago, the total amount of scholarships that we gave for 5 conferences was like $5,000. With the new trust agreement that was written in 2020, we were able to invest funds in a different venue such that we would be able to get more interest so that our children, we would be able to support them in a better way. Thank you so much, and God bless each of you.
James LeVert Davis, Mother Arellis Beavers Davis, and the members of the Second Episcopal District. The Theological Education Scholarship Committee is pleased to make the following report. The Word of God declares in 2 Timothy 2:15, "Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved by Him, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly explaining the word of truth." This is a guiding principle for those pursuing and serving in the vocation of ministry and undergirds the work of this committee. The Theological Education Scholarship and Assistance Program, otherwise known as TSAP, offers financial assistance for seminary students in the Second Episcopal District, funded entirely through the generosity of Bishop Davis and financial support from members of the Second District. TSAP support is limited to those in the Board of Examiners process and pursuing the MDiv from a seminary accredited by the Association of Theological Schools, otherwise known as ATS. There are two types of financial assistance available. The first is tuition assistance for those attending Payne Theological Seminary or Turner Theological Seminary. TSAP provides 50% of tuition for both the fall and spring semesters. The second form of financial assistance is a book grant available to students attending an ATS seminary. Book grant amounts vary from year to year based on fund availability. The committee is pleased to report that 54 awards were given last conference year in the fall and spring semesters to students in all five conferences. For more information, we encourage you to contact your conference coordinator, and please remember, complete applications are due no later than August 1st. 2023. Finally, the committee makes the following recommendation. In an effort to meet the tuition assistance needs of all applying and eligible students, the committee recommends that tuition assistance remain at 50% for MDiv students attending Payne Seminary or Turner Seminary, and book grants remain at an amount determined by Bishop Davis. This is consistent with the recommendation originally approved at the 2022 summer planning meeting. Respectfully submitted by your committee, the Reverend Dr. Carrington Carter, Second District Chair, Reverend Dr. Marietta Ramsey, Baltimore Conference, Reverend Dr. Anna Emosby, Washington Conference, Reverend Vanessa Copeland, Virginia Conference, Reverend Judy Johnson, North Carolina Conference, Reverend Dr. Wayne Beatty, Western North Carolina Conference. We thank you, Bishop Davis, for the opportunity to serve.
And Bishop Davis, also we want to thank and welcome Reverend Wayne Johnson, our newest member, to replace Reverend Beatty from the Western North Carolina Conference. That's our report.
Second District done a phenomenal job in making sure that you put your money where your mouth is as it relates to the importance and support of our seminary students and families, particularly in all seminaries around the country in general. Go right ahead. We ask that all of the reports, and we are asking, seriously asking, all the reports, we want them to be as brief as possible. We do want to get out of here in order to give you a rest between the services. Go right ahead.
Bishop Davis, Mother Davis, Bishop McCloud, and to the Summer Summit. I'm Chaplain Josephine Pinkney, United States Air Force retired,
and I'm the coordinator for the 2nd Episcopal District. Before we get started, Bishop Davis, I would just like you to know that last year you allowed us to present the presentation about the flag folding ceremony. And the first fold of the flag represents life. The second fold represents our belief in eternal life. What you've given to the 2nd Episcopal District is life for our veterans. Will all veterans please stand if you possibly can? Let's give them a hand. Bishop Davis, because you've given us life, we say thank you. This is the flag that was flown over the hostile skies of Iraq in 2001 and I was deployed to Saudi Arabia, and we want to make sure that we say thank you in a very special way. May God bless you. Our slides, I don't see them up, but I'll just go through it real quickly. Our mission is to encourage and assist churches in the 2nd Episcopal District to establish a military-friendly congregation. Many of you have already done this, but we are encouraging all of you to please, please recognize your veterans in your congregations. We want to give special recognition to all of our World War II vets because they are really dying quickly at this moment. We would like also for you to consider presenting the Vietnam War veterans the presidential proclamation. Our community is the last community to receive the proclamation from the Department of Defense. And I really need your help because I have proclamations signed by President Biden, and we need to get them out to people in your community, in your churches, and they don't have them. We also have the lapel pin. I work with the Military Chaplains Association, and we want to make sure that our community is well represented and receives what they so deserve. We would also like, if you need help in creating a ministry, please, please let me know. The next thing is, we are very, very excited. November 11th, Veterans Day. Veterans Day. Many of you have already started inviting people to your church to preach. Even someone in your congregation could be a speaker for Veterans Day. We highly encourage that. Our speaker this year on our Zoom will be Lieutenant General R. Scott Dingle, and he's the Army Surgeon General and Commanding Medical Command. He is the 45th Surgeon General of the United States Army, and he's also an ordained clergy. So we encourage you to please, please, please watch, tell your congregations. We will be on Zoom on November 11, 2023, and we highly encourage you to be with us. Thank you so much, Bishop Davis, for the opportunity to serve and making a difference in our lives. God bless you.
Amen.
We have coins for anyone who would like a coin. Chaplain Jenny Harrison would like to present those coins. If you can see her at the back at any time. Anyone wanting to be a part of this ministry, please let me know. We would be excited to have you as a part of this ministry. God bless you. Amen.
Good afternoon. Bishop Davis, Mother Davis, Bishop McLeod. We greet you with our action plan for the health committee for the 2023-24 year. We have three action areas that we will focus on. First, support, educate, and connect.
So first, with support, we will continue to support the agenda of the International Health Commission of the AMS Church. We are also available to support any church, any presiding elder district or annual conference that is looking for support with programming or connecting to professionals in our district.
Our second focus area is education. The International Health Commission has a partnership with the Alzheimer's Association. By 2030, 40% of all Alzheimer's patients will be African American. So that will be our whole focus this coming up year. In my professional career, I'm working to bring the ALTA program, Altered Dementia Program, to Virginia, and it basically helps prepare congregations for dementia-friendly congregations. And so I've already contacted a few AME churches that are going to be partners, but the training will encompass the second Episcopal district. This program was founded by Dr. Fayron Epps at Emory University in Atlanta. And there are several AME churches who are already partners throughout the United States, but we'll have AME churches here in Virginia coming up this year, so we're really excited about that. Also, we will bring caregiver support resources to the district this year because so many people take care of people with dementia and Alzheimer's and other dementia-related illnesses. So Virginia has the Virginia Memory Project. There are programs in North Carolina, D.C., and Maryland to help connect people with resources for dementia and dementia caregivers. So that's our second component for our plan. Okay. And our last area is connection. So we know there are so many talented people who work in healthcare or health education throughout this district, but we don't know everyone. So we want to get a list of at least 50 volunteers who are willing to serve as volunteers for health fairs, speakers, Zooms. So if you are one of those people who would like to volunteer your services in healthcare to this district, we would love to have you aboard and assist. And you can feel free to email us at amesedhealth@gmail.com. And we look forward to hearing from you. And that concludes our report.
Thank you. Thank you for the prayer ministry who's been serving us all day.
Everyone who's a member of the prayer ministry, if you would please stand. If you're here, members of the prayer ministry. Thank you. In light of the world in which we live, if I was on the street, I would say the world was going to in a handbasket, especially our country. Scripture reminds us that we are the salt of the earth. We are the salt of the earth. I would dare say that there's less of a problem with SCOTUS and more of a problem with us. I'm going to say that again. There's less of a problem with SCOTUS and more of a problem with us. We are the salt. Salt does several things. Salt seasons. Salt preserves. In ancient times, salt was used as a fertilizer. And salt was used as a weed killer. How many of you can say that we need some seasoning? We are not preserving that which was already done.
Yeah.
We're losing it.
All right.
Okay? Not only that, we need to fertilize what it is that we're trying to do. And we need to choke out some weeds. We need to be the salt. We are reminded in Scripture that Jesus said to the disciples and hence to us, greater works than these we shall you do. We are the body of Christ. The works that we should be doing should be greater works. Greater works. But in that same pericope, he talks about how to make that happen. And he said, if you ask in my name. So greater works is a byproduct of prayer. The goal of the prayer ministry is to undergird the greater works vision of our bishop. That's our purpose, to undergird his vision with prayer. To that end, on a weekly basis, we are developing prayer foci and themes around his vision. Additionally, this year, we would like to look at each component and every component's vision in every component's action item. This year, we plan to make sure you see your component's vision and action item as a prayer foci for a particular week. So that as a district, we are praying on one accord. And the day of Pentecost tells you what happens when people are on one accord. Second district, can we be on one accord in prayer? On one accord in prayer, that we might be salt, that we might be light, that we might do greater works. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Give them a hand. Summary contact. Dr. Luzon is the person in charge of these thriving congregations. We'll give her a minute to say a word about that as well. It applies to those of you, particularly those of you who have been benefactors thereof, resources that have been provided. Dr. Luzon,
Thank you, Bishop, and thank you for the opportunity to serve. I do want to say for those who have already received Thriving Congregation grants, particularly since they came during COVID, we got delayed by 2 years in terms of our full implementation. And in working with Lily, we'll be able to stretch that out. But the money will be gone when Bishop Davis leaves. So please, in your ministry reports and your evaluations by, I'm going to say May of 2024. The second piece is I want to let you know that we do have some monies that we can still give to some of our congregations. What we did notice is that there are two ways to be churches right now. You can survive. It's good. It's Sunday. I got Bible study. I'm online. I do prayer. Or you can thrive. You can start developing some things. You can start prospering. You can start thinking differently. And how can I make where I serve last beyond my tenure at that church? And a lot of us only think, I'm going to be the next whoever you think you're going to be. And it's going to be based upon what I've done while I'm here. And that's not what it's about. We're supposed to be lifting up Jesus as our congregations thrive. And if we focus on Jesus and having ministry that promotes Jesus to our community within and without the church, we'll be better churches. So I say all that to say that we have an opportunity now to include more churches in our thriving congregations. Please don't think about this in terms of money. Think about it in terms of ministry. What are you going to do to help those people in your church who need spiritual growth and those people in the community who are what we call now nuns and sons and maybe they're not even thinking about church? How are we going to produce ministries that are going to move the whole community of Christ forward? Rather than showing my slides, I'm going to ask that if you need further information, you want to apply, please send an email to me, not at my personal email. That's what a lot of you do because that's not what I'm looking for. Please send it to sedrcrp@gmail.com. Again, that's sedrcrp@gmail.com. And I want to say, initially it's only supposed to be rural congregations, but because of what's been going on in many of our cities, we have asked Lily and they have agreed that we can expand it to communities where we have lower resources. I know many of you heard about the shooting in Baltimore City, and I do want to thank Reverend Bennett who's there now, but that shooting occurred 2 blocks from Fairhaven's AME. So I want to let you know that there are things available that we can do to address what's going on in our community. Thank you, Bishop.
Give her a hand. Reverend Grant Edwards to come, Reverend Valdez to come on quickly, the Reverend Dr. Ettore Goggins, Reverend Billy Hunter, Reverend Jonathan Davis, come on and summarize your reports as well. And we are going to be ready to move out of here after we take a look at the calendar, and we've already asked you to stay connected. Come on.
Very quickly, repeat after me, if every soul wins a soul,
every soul wins a soul,
and every soul will be saved.
Every soul will be saved.
Evangelism is something that we cannot allow to die in our congregations. And we want to introduce to you the word frangelism. Everybody say frangelism. Instead of going to somebody and getting your pocketbook snatched because you don't know them, start in your Jerusalem. Frangelism beginning with friends, relatives, associates, and neighbors. Say that with me. Friends, relatives, associates, neighbors. Stewards are asked to bring at least one person to Christ. We're not just limiting this to stewards under the leadership of the pastors. And we also want everybody to know, some people just don't know how to witness on the Second Episcopal District e-learning portal. We will have a template there that will explain how to witness, how to lead someone to Christ, how to provide post-salvation aftercare, how to acclimate new souls into your church, into our churches, and how to receive souls virtually, how to receive souls online, because oftentimes there are people that are watching us virtually, and we lose them because that proper apparatus is not set up to receive those souls. Thank you, Bishop Davis.
All right, thank you for very much. What we're going to do tomorrow in the steward and trustee workshop after Bishop McLeod. Can you hear me?
No.
After Bishop McLeod, or part of Bishop McLeod's presentation, is to talk some more to the stewards and trustees, in particular about what we're going to be asking them to do. Give Reverend Brent Edwards a hand for sharing this. All right, come on, task force, tell us what we can look forward to and where we are.
Okay, wonderful. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
And if you
Task Force and our annual conferences, please stand. Bishop Davis, Mother Davis, and Bishop McLeod, thank you all so much for giving me the opportunity to give this report. I'm just going to provide just an update to where we are with the SED Legislation Task Force in preparation for the General Conference 2024 through your committees, through the annual conferences. We have been collecting and receiving proposed legislation. To date, we've had 15 proposed legislations, three from Baltimore, three from Washington Conference, three from Virginia Conference, one from North Carolina Conference, and five from the Western North Carolina Conference. I've had calls from individuals that are trying to provide some legislation on clergy 40 and under, as well as chaplaincy. Some of the things in which we've collected, just so that you can get an idea, so that you will go back and maybe submit some proposed legislation. We have had annuity funds and insurance stability, continuing education for clergy within the annual conference, including all exhorters, evangelists, local, itinerant deacons, and elders, offered through the BOE of an annual conference, continuing education for local deacons and elders, documentation for pastoral transition, ministerial pastoral support, procedure for receiving ordained preachers from other denominations, retirement benefits for local deacons and elders serving pastors, the training of clergy candidates from another conference by the BOE, trustee participation in the negotiation of pastors' housing allowance, revisions to the Commission of Financial Management, providing IRS documentation for the clergy housing allowance exclusion, the commission, a commission on internal audit, an alternative service for itinerant elders, that is a recognition of elders outside of pastoring, and training for evangelists and exhorters. So that, I just gave the title, I didn't go into the detail, but I want you to know that the Second Episcopal District, we are trying to drive the way that we do business in the AME Church. We know that it is through our discipline, it is through our proposed legislation, is how we get things changed. So please do not sit and just say, hey, I do not like how something is going. You have the opportunity now to make a difference by submitting proposed legislation to your annual conference task force. That's all that I have right now. I have a larger report for you. The deadline that we have to submit the connectional legislation is May of 2024. However, we will be collecting them through September, is that right? Through September, and we will come together as a total task force to really look at all of the proposed legislations and decide what we will clean them up, of course, and decide what we will submit as coming from the Second Episcopal District.
And would you also make them aware of the fact that we agreed that on the fourth Thursday of October is when we call the district together, because it won't be the task force that decides what will or won't be sent on with the signature of the Second District, but on the fourth Thursday night, and if it's necessary, we'll go to the next Thursday night as well to use that time to review the legislation that has been submitted to the task force.
Thank you. And the email address is wclegislation@gmail.com. We look forward to receiving your proposed legislation. Thank you, Bishop.
All right, thank you, and give them a hand. All right. These are the folk who put together all of this statistical report. If you turn to page 36, they are summarized very quickly because we can see where you are.
Yeah, we have a video presentation, yes. Right. And I'm going to ask all the statisticians who are present, please stand.
right.
Is this one of those reality shows? No, this is the real church. What's the difference? Reality shows are written by a team of writers. It is produced by producers who hire a cast of actors. The producers decide what is seen and what is unseen. Reality shows have props and staged obstacles. These shows have narrated performances, and what you think you see on TV is a cast of performers that makes you believe what you see is real. The real church dares to believe in a real God that leads, guides, and directs their steps. The real church dares to believe in the work of God and performs its mission in places whether televised or not. When you see the real church in operation, you know that it is real. The real church is where real challenges and real life situations are overcome by the power of God, and real people daring to believe that through God, all things are possible. This statistician's report will provide the statistical evidence of how the real church has risen above the challenges of our people to serve God and the communities around them. Roll the credits. Thank you. our dynamic Episcopal team, Bishop James Lewis and one of the most leaders days, and for their anointed leadership in the entirety of the Second Episcopal District.
To make sure that the Conference Entertainment Committee will receive
there as many of the instructions for your ability to go on and start planning right away, quick and in a hurry, to make sure that we don't run into the problems of not being able to get the facilities where that is available, the facilities where that is appropriate. And so we ask you to make sure that you do. The final word, those of you who are not aware, with all the clergy, please stand, all clergy, whatever you, clergy in trial, clergy in preparation, clergy in retirement, clergy in local, all clergy. You have a wonderful, 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 wonderful program and retreat scheduled for you. Dr. Boyd, are you still in the room? She's not in the, are you still, Dr. Boyd? She's not in the room at this time. I assure you that the brochures that I have seen says that you are in store for a real learning and wonderful experience. So please, you may be seated now. All of you have been encouraged to be in the clergy retreat. I think that's a final word of appreciation with all of the presiding on this, please stand. And certainly, as I've spoken of your spouses and spouses, please, if your mate is here, would she or he stand now? All of the presiding elders, and let me ask all of you to join with me in giving a thunderous round of applause to these guys. Thank you so very much. I'm grateful. Let me ask again, those of you who were not here this morning, I presented her because she is indeed my best friend, and all the time I'm anxious to show her all. Orellis Antonio Sudetta Rayo Bevis Davis. Yes, and so with my all of these folks in the second district. Yes to her when she asked me that. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. If I ever do want to say it. Miss Dr. Reed, would you please stand? Let me recognize your presence with appreciation. Certainly, you're already